Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the 22nd meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2022. This is our last meeting before summer recess. At agenda item one, we have consideration of whether to take items 4, 5, 6, 7 and 8 in private. Item 4 is consideration of a draft report on our energy price rises inquiry. Item 5 is consideration of evidence we will hear today. Item 6 is consideration of our work programme. Item 7 is a consideration of a draft report on a legislative consent memorandum for the high-speed rail Crewe to Manchester bill. And finally, item 8 is consideration of evidence we heard last week as part of our inquiry into the role of local government and its cross-sectoral partners in financing and delivering in Net Zero Scotland. Do we agree to take these items in private?
Yes.
That is agreed. Thank you very much. Items 4 to 8 will be taken in private. Item 2 is our first evidence session in relation to our inquiry into a modern and sustainable ferry service for Scotland. This new inquiry aims to seek out how best to secure ferry services that are future-proofed, compatible with Scotland's net zero goals and meets the needs of all service users, especially the island communities that depend on them. Today we are opening with a scene-setting evidence session. We are going to hear from a panel of people from islands across Scotland about their experience of ferry services and their views on the remit of our inquiry. We've published a draft remit for feedback from the public. That remit is subject to views and opinions and feedback we will receive today. So I welcome our six panellists, all of whom are joining us remotely. We have Sam Bourne, Chairman, Arran Ferry Action Group, Gary McLean, Vice Convener, Isla Community Council Ferry Committee, Margaret Morrison, Chair, Harris Transport Forum, Lawrence Odey, Chairman, Yale Community Council, Joe Reid, Chair, Mull and Iona Ferry Committee, and Paul Riley, Transport Representative of Stronsay Community Council. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the committee. Thank you very much for joining us. We very much look forward to hearing your views on the first evidence session in relation to this inquiry. We've got about 90 minutes for this session. Because we have a large panel, I would suggest that, if possible, we keep questions and answers as concise as possible. We are very interested to hear, obviously, your feedback, but we're also keen to explore as many issues as possible this morning. So let me start and go straight to questions. The first question I have is a general question. We have obviously seen significant disruptions to ferry services over the past few years. But what I would like to understand better is the real day-to-day impact this disruption has on island communities. So I'd like to ask each of you, what are the day-to-day impacts that you have had to manage as a result of the constant disruptions you have experienced with ferry services? And if I could start with each of you in turn, if I could start with Sam Bourne and then move to Gary McLean, please. So Sam, over to you, please.
Good morning. Committee, and firstly, let me commend you for taking on this inquiry. I think we'd all agree that we're now at a very critical juncture in Scotland's ferry service provision, and this inquiry is vital in trying to understand the issues and how we may be able to solve them. So let's think of some of the day-to-day impacts that an island such as Arran suffers. It can't be overestimated and overstated how reliant Arran is on a reliable ferry service. Examples range from residents attempting to get to medical appointments on the mainland hospitals. That's a fairly common tale, particularly difficult during the winter when disruption is inevitably higher through weather and technical issues due to overhaul. That has a huge knock-on effect. For us, our nearest major hospital is Cross House near Kilmarnock. To make an appointment, you need to be getting one of the earlier ferries of the day, and to get home again, you need to be ensuring to get on either the afternoon or the evening ferry. If either of those are disrupted, you're either not making your appointment with all the knock-on effect that will have, potentially, or you're needing to stay overnight. it's not unusual to hear stories of residents having to spend to go a couple of days early to make sure they can make their appointment that they've been may have been waiting for you know, in the current climate, 6 months or more, for occasionally, sometimes very, very important appointments. But that's just one small example, and it stretches through to the island producers not being able to get their products to market reliably, farmers not being able to get their animals to live to market. The other way, coming onto the island, goods and services. Suppliers are less keen to do deliveries on the island because of the risk of their drivers and vehicles then getting trapped for a day or more. And during January, I think we had one occasion where we had five co-op lorries stuck on the island for a couple of days. And that has a huge knock-on effect for the co-op delivery system as well. So there are so many effects throughout the whole community and economy. And we haven't even got to talking about the effect on the tourism and hospitality industry, with the lack of ability for people to be able to plan reliably to come and go on their holidays, which with the modern economies of the island are so tourism reliant, especially on the likes of Arran, that it's an essential economic fact. So that it really can't be overstated how many and varied the impacts are, and I'm sure the other panelists will echo very similar experiences.
Okay, great. Many thanks, Sam. You've raised a number of issues there. Very, very helpful introduction that I'm sure the committee will explore when we get to other questions. If I could ask the same question of Gary McLean, and after that I'll bring in Margaret Morrison. Gary, over to you, please.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. A very apt question you've asked, Convener, because the Hebridean Isles has actually broken down at the moment. So Isla is now without three round-trip sailings for the last two or three days, if memory serves. So I think the real crux of this is that capacity and reliability are so, so important to our island community, because at the end of the day, this is very much a lifeline ferry service for the local community. So it's very difficult to assess the impact day to day, other than to echo what Sam has said. I mean, it could be people needing to, local community trying to go to the mainland to fulfill appointments, go shopping, see family, to basically live a normal life that's not impeded by our slightly more remote location. And as for business, I mean, we have 9 functioning whiskey distilleries on this island, which requires goods coming in, goods going out, which are all quite time sensitive. So we have a large freight capacity. We require a large freight capacity, sorry. So if any little cog in the machines breaks down, it has a disproportionate effect on everyone else. And in our case, it happens to be the ferries all too regularly, unfortunately. And with the whisky industry comes tourism, from which a lot of people derive their primary income, either directly or sort of tangentially to it. And if people have a bad experience, they're less likely to come back. If they try to book and there's not availability at a time which is convenient, they will go elsewhere. So I think the disruption is something that really can't be overestimated. I think that's all I'll add just now. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Gary. That you mentioned a couple of important points about tourism, the impact on tourism and business, which we want to follow up on a bit later. Let me bring in Margaret Morrison. Again, the same question about overall day-to-day impact in terms of disruptions.
Good morning, committee members and fellow panellists. In Harris, we are absolutely beyond anxious with a constant stream of service withdrawals, which is undermining island life hugely. I have lived here since 1987. I run a business and I'm also an essential worker who has gone travel through the islands. And what we're finding is that I have never seen such anxiety amongst population. Visitors coming to the islands who have said to me, we will not return because of the situation with the ferries, which, to be perfectly honest, is utterly chaotic at the moment. We've had service withdrawals in the last fortnight on several of our ferries, which has resulted in visitors either being stuck on one island and not able to get to another, having problems with accommodation, being cancelled. And to be perfectly honest, I feel that we have met, we have discussed and we have talked, and we are at a total impasse with CalMac, with the Scottish Government. We get nowhere. We will never see young people coming to our islands to set up business as long as we have this problem. And we are also facing a six-month closure of our main ferry terminal in Harris, and the impact of that is going to be significant. And we feel that something has to be done, because we are at the moment, even to go off island, you become anxious about booking a ferry because you can't book one. We get told, well, you have the Lough Seaforth in Stornoway. Then when you try to book that, we get told it's full. And then you ask locally to be told you can't get availability. So we've got the chaos from the booking system added to the unreliability of the vessels, which are now so old, they are breaking down frequently. And as I've said before, I came here in 1987, and I don't ever remember having those issues with the ferries. Yes, they were weather dependent. We've always accepted that. But this has reached an all-time critical situation. And I feel that the islands of the Western Isles are really at the point of almost extinction of our businesses. And our morale is so low. We have no confidence left in CalMac and the Scottish Government, because they ask us what we want, we tell them, and absolutely nothing is done about it. So the situation here, I cannot stress just how dreadful we are all feeling about the situation with the ferries in Harris.
Well, Margaret, thank you very much for that introduction, and sorry to hear of the impact the community is facing. Let me ask Joe Reid to come in on the same question in terms of day-to-day disruption as a result of ferry services.
Yeah, good morning. Well, I'd echo everything that's been said so far. I think it's important to remember that every island is different, so every island has different problems. They have sometimes very different ferry services. I mean, Mull is a relatively, relatively close to the mainland. We have a relatively frequent service. We're lucky in that regard. But then look, for example, to our near neighbours on Col and Tyree, who have, a handful of sailings each week, and only one service. And if they have disruption, particularly in the winter due to breakdowns or weather, that they're completely isolated for days or at a time. Their shelves go bare. It really has a really severe impact, particularly on those small and vulnerable islands, but on all islands. As you've been hearing, the problem is widespread. We have sort of two crises, if you like. In the winter, we have a crisis of reliability. That's when we feel the reliability crisis worst, because that's when all the dry docking is trying to happen. They're trying to squeeze in huge dry dock schedule that often overruns. So we have this logistical Rubik's Cube in the winter, which never runs to plan. We have weather cancellations, which are increasing. The winter, the reliability is declining really badly, to the point where people can no longer depend on the service that they used to be able to depend upon. We cannot rely on the service anymore. It's a guessing game often, particularly in the winter. We look at the weather forecast. Will it sail? Won't it? Which ferry is on? What's the likelihood? Should I go on that service or should I go on another? If I've got an important appointment to make, maybe I should go a day early just to be sure of making it. It all adds to the cost of life. It deteriorates the quality of life. It's really appalling. And so we've got that awful situation in the winter, and then in the summer, yes, the reliability issues continue, but actually the summer problem, particularly on the busiest islands, is one of capacity. There's a complete lack of capacity in the system. So whereas in the winter, it's a guessing game as to whether the ferry will sail or not. In the summer, it's a guess, we just know that unless we book weeks in advance, we're not going to get a place because the ferries are full. There just is insufficient capacity. Demand has been stimulated by RET, but absolutely nothing was done to prepare for it. So these problems are not fleeting problems. These are not operational issues. These are strategic failures. These are strategic failures to plan over decades. There's a strategic failure to plan for the impact of RET, a strategic failure to plan for vessel replacement and make sure it's done timeously. The system has been lacking from proper governance and planning over decades, and it's crumbling. 801, 802 is a symptom of a failing system. It's not the cause of a failing system. It really is, pretty dire, and it needs to be assessed from a blank sheet of paper. How could the system be better delivered? Look abroad, look to the exemplars abroad of the best ferry services, take the best of them and apply them to Scotland, because Scotland has one of the worst public ferry systems in the world in relation to the amount of money that is spent on it. And that's the other point to make, is that this is not necessarily about needing more money. The sums of money being spent on the ferry service are eye-watering, but it's being spent appallingly badly. The outcome for that money that's being spent is terrible. If you were to look at the public money being spent per head or of population or per passenger carried, and compare it with near neighbours like Norway, I think you'll find that it's a really shockingly high figure. And we need to spend our money better, and it's of critical importance to the islands. For all the reasons that the other speakers have said, it's really eroding the quality of life. It's making business on the islands far more risky. It's leading to depopulation. People are actually leaving the islands because of the unreliability of the ferry service, because life on the islands is no longer sustainable without that uncertainty and risk of whether they can get on or off the island, and particularly for the most vulnerable, particularly for the elderly or the ill. People who are going for regular cancer treatment, who can't get to their appointments, for example. These are the people that are worst affected by this, but then this continuous erosion of the quality of life for us all could go on, but I think that's probably enough for me for the moment.
Okay, Joe, thank you very much for that overview. You raised a number of very serious issues there, which the committee will want to explore further. Let me bring in Lawrence Odey again on the same question, please.
Hello. Sorry. I have lost most of the meeting because my broadband got cut off for a wee while, which is in a rural area. A little bit different. We've had a very good service up until recently, but we do have weather problems in the wintertime, but the main problem we have is unreliability because of either staffing or maintenance problems. And it has a big effect on the island where I stay. Most of the younger people under 50, have actually left to the mainland because they had been started commuting on a daily basis to their work, and now they just move out. The other thing is we have a large fish processing factory that puts out almost 20,000 tonne of salmon per year, and they have difficulty getting out at times. They have to catch the second ferry, the Northlink ferry, to get their goods to mainland Scotland. So the whole thing is almost a crisis point here as well.
Okay, Lawrence, thank you very much. I'm glad we were able to get you back online, and your connection was good there. So thank you very much for that introduction. Let me bring in Paul Riley on the same question, the same opening question on the impacts on day-to-day life as a result of ferry disruptions.
Thank you very much, both for the opportunity to speak to you, but also for the opportunity to express the views of, I think, most of the Northern Isles in Orkney, that is. I am on the Stronsay Community Council as a transport rep, but I also have a representation here to speak for Edie, North Ronaldsay, Sandy and Westry, the other islands. Populations range from 50 to nearly 1,000 on each different island. The main problem that we feel exists is that the local ferries and planes in Orkney are akin to the bus rail services in northern Scotland. They're essential. They're not just convenient. In our experience, we have, in particular in our section of Orkney, three vessels serving islands. All three vessels were built before 1990, all past use-by dates. They're still fairly sound, but when they go away for maintenance, they come back, and within a few weeks, one, two, or even all three have to go back for further work. This shows the reliability of the service is compromised. And as far as we can tell, no provision being made for the supply of any ferries. Nothing in the pipeline, as far as we're aware, islands. Nothing is being done by Orkney Island Council or by the Scottish Government to take this further. And I would have thought it was fundamentally essential. Having got our ferries, the real and we have a plane service as well, the question still comes up, anybody with mobility issues. The planes are small, 8-seaters. They are very reliable, very good pilots, as good a service as can be for most of the islands. The ferries, however, have of the three ferries that we use, only one has some sort of disability access, and that is sometimes simply not working because it involves a lift, which apparently can't be used every now and then. So anybody any mobility issues faces a serious problem getting to the island by plane or by sea. I think overall, though the quality of life on the islands is generally good, it depends very much, not only for the current population, but for the future of the islands, very much on the sustainability of the service. And this needs to be addressed as far as we think this needs to be addressed urgently. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Paul. That was a very important introduction you provided in terms of the impact of ferry disruptions. Let me bring in Fiona Hislop for further questions.
Good morning, and thank you all for your powerful statements about the current situation. We want to hear from you to help shape and scope our report and our investigation. And so therefore, you know, your views, yes, on the short term, but also on the medium and long term is really important. So I'm keen to hear from you as to what you think we as a committee should be looking at and what the main priorities for you would be. Can I first come to Joe Reid? You talked about the need for looking at things with a blank sheet of paper. If we're going to inform the next connectivity ferry plan, what are the things that you think should be put in place and what should we look at for the medium and long term in particular? And I'll come to the other members and the convener will keep me correct on time. Hopefully I can hear from all of you if we can. But I'll come to Joe first because you raised that.
Hi, thanks. Well, at the core of this is the quality of the decision making. And how those decisions are influenced. And at the moment, the system that we have is giving us very poor outcomes, poor decisions and poor outcomes. And so I think you need to look at, yes, the fundamental structure of how the system is organised, fundamental structure of how a ferry service is delivered and what is the best way to deliver a ferry service. When you look at Scotland's system, you know, we have this bizarre and bizarre separation of vessel owner and vessel operator, which is completely artificial. And then Transport Scotland and government trying to often kind of micromanage operations that are done by these other two organisations. So we have these three organisations without it really being clear who is in charge, who's making decisions, who's making those strategic decisions. To give an example of how the you know that artificial relationship between, you know, vessel owner and vessel operator works. We apparently have a system where every 6 years the service is tendered. You know, that would on the face of it result in a competitive tendering situation where you get the best operator offering best value for money. Well, the driver of cost within the ferry service are the vessels. That's where all of your operating costs are. The huge majority of your operating costs are in the vessels. But yet when the tendering happens, the operator who is tendering has absolutely no control over those operating costs because they are obliged to use the vessels that CMAL give them. And the flip side of that is that when a vessel is being renewed, being replaced, as for example, as just happening on Isla now, that process is going through now, the decisions that go into that vessel design and bake in those operating costs in terms of vessel size, how many crew on the vessel, whether the crew are, you know, live aboard or live ashore, you know, how much fuel it burns, all those key decisions around the operating cost of the vessel are being taken on the one hand by CMAL, who have absolutely no relationship to, you know, their success or otherwise is completely unrelated to the financial success of CalMAC. So if they specify a high cost vessel, it makes no difference to them. It makes no difference to their outcome, to their business or personal outcome. And CalMAC also, can specify a vessel, but it doesn't make any difference. You know, there's no opportunity for a competitor to offer a different vessel because they know that the vessel they specify now is the same vessel that any competitor is going to be obliged to use. So they have no incentive. I'm not saying that that's the actual explicit thought process that goes through, you know, goes through management's mind in CMAL or CalMAC, but these are the implicit pressures on them that there is no commercial pressure. There's no incentive for them to make good decisions so far as those vessels are concerned. Because, you know, whether a vessel needs a crew of 12 or a crew of 27 makes no difference to the bottom line of CalMAC or CMAL. Because whatever the operating cost is, we pick it up. You know, whatever the deficit is, and it's currently about £150 million a year, the operating costs alone, before you buy vessels, before you spend money on piers, £150 million a year is the operating deficit of CalMac. And that's because there is massive inefficiency and waste in the system, because we have crews that are far bigger than is typical in the rest of the commercial world. We have vessels that are far more complex, that are bespoke, one-off designs, that are very time-consuming and expensive to build. They're very fuel-thirsty. And all of these decisions are baked into the design of procurement because no one has an incentive to make better decisions. The question is, how do you incentivize the decision-makers to make better decisions?
Right.
So if it's within a public system, and if it remains within a public system, what are the structures that you create that incentivize better decision making?
Okay.
Or you have a truly competitive situation, as you do in Norway, where they have one of the best public ferry services in the world. You have a truly competitive situation where the operator of the vessels is also the owner of the vessel, and they compete for the right to government subsidy to operate a service on the basis of their efficiency and productivity. So their decisions are linked to their financial performance, their business performance.
Thank you, Joe. I understand your committee has also looked at international experience, so if you could perhaps indicate to our clerks separately where you think we should be looking at, that would be helpful. But I'm conscious we need to hear from everybody. I know we started late, so apologies. So if I can maybe come to Margaret Morrison next. And you know, the weather issues are going to be with us, climate change is with us, and that's going to be an issue that we're going to have to factor in. But you talked about the need to have sustainability for businesses, and also we want repopulation. So what would you like us as a committee to look at, and what should be the things that we want to see from our ferry service that we can advise and inform and indeed hold the government to account on? What are your key priorities?
Our key priorities, from Harris' perspective, what we were asking for, we think this is a simple ask, and I appreciate it may not be, but we're looking for a Western Isles network made up of six large ferries, with two deployed to serve in Stornoway, and a dedicated ferry on the routes from Tarbert, Loch Maddy, Loch Boisdale and Castlebay, plus two smaller ferries to serve the Sound of Harris and Sound of Barra. Dedicated ferries will provide greater capacity and frequency in normal times, and resilience will improve with the ability to cover any breakdowns, which are happening now, I'm afraid, with monotonous regularity, and also when the vessels go to dry dock. And the operations and management of the network should be based within the Western Isles, because what we're finding is we need to manage our service locally. Their management is based many, many miles away, and it's very a confusing management structure. And we just feel that immediately what would really help would be the opportunity to charter an overnight freight service on the Allopol-Stornoway route. We've talked about this again. We've talked ad nauseum about this, and we get told that the freight ferries, the Petalina springs to mind, is not fit for purpose. We hear this from CMAL. What would it take to make it fit for purpose? Because we are closing down for 6 months in Harris in October, and that's not far away at all. We were told we would have extra sailings on the Seaforth. This, to date, we have had no word that this is going to be a reality. And what we fear happening is is happening right at the moment. We have no availability in the Loch Seaforth. People from Harris will have to leave home very early in the morning to sit in a wait queue and then to watch the ferry closing, and you make your way back to Harris. So in the immediate, what we're really looking for is, we have a mezzanine deck on the Hebrides, and you would think this is not a huge problem because a mezzanine deck is to add extra capacity. However, we are told that it cannot be used on all sailings because there's issues with crew. There is money which CalMac need to open the mezzanine deck to allow extra capacity. Scottish Government refused to give Transport Scotland the money. Again, we've got all those layers of bureaucracy who are making our life so intolerable. So we feel that this has to be, the mezzanine deck on the Hebrides should be reinstated as soon as possible. We would ask for postponement of the closure of Umud Pier for 12 months until we can find alternative sailings or additional capacity can be secured. We get told that additional capacity is a problem, and we've had meetings with Kevin Hobbs, who has told us that acquiring the vessels that are appropriate for our route are very difficult. We understand this, and we know that I'm quite sure he's trying his best, but just to say nothing is available can't be done. We hear this so often. And we're in a desperate situation, and we really have to have scrutiny of those decisions. And why can we not get available capacity? Why is this not happening? And it's interesting that there's not an island representative on the CalMAC board, and I wonder where people get their advice from, because if people sitting on the CalMAC desk have never been sitting in a car waiting to get onto a ferry or being extremely anxious get back home or to come to the mainland, then they don't have that felt experience. I'm an NHS worker. I have stood in the rain, having been told that the ferry is full to capacity, to find it's half empty, and I've walked on. I applied to join the CalMAC board. I was told I wasn't suitable. I don't know what makes anybody more suitable than somebody who's actually had that experience. And also, again, I come back to a design and implementation of a new, simpler management structure with fewer decisions taken in the Central Belt, because it's like any experience in life. You have to be there just to understand how traumatic it is to be told you can't get on a ferry and there's nowhere for you to stay wherever you are. And I think a clear set of tangible milestones for the launch of 802. Again, we're extremely concerned this is going to become a Cinderella vessel. Huge efforts, I think, will go into completing the Glen Sannox in an attempt to salvage reputations. But and then, and only then, will we get attention given to 802. And it's we really worry that the recently ordered vessels for Isla Jura, due in 2024, will actually be in service before vessel 802. And I really don't want to miss this opportunity just to explain to you the importance of the ferries to Harris and to all our Hebridean islands, and the severity of this current crisis, and the collapse in confidence that we all have. And my fear is that we're going to see an island full of elderly people who don't always want to travel. Our young will not come back and work here because of this, unless the situation is resolved. So I really hope that we get listened to, but nothing ever gets done. So I'm really hoping that today this committee will take on board our concerns and try and help us and support us. Thank you.
Thank you, Margaret. And indeed, your MSP, Alistair Allen, raised the UIG issue, and it's Highland Council that owns the ports. There's something really interesting about decision making, that distance of management, the fact that any policy should have lived experience as part of that. And I think the repopulation of the islands should be something that we look at as well. So that's very helpful. And obviously, crewing and staffing is an issue we've heard from others. So can I maybe come to Sam Bourne next, and that issue about community decision making. I understand there are a number of different organisations in Arran that want to inform what happens with the ferries and obviously the businesses. What do you think good community consultation looks like, and how do you work with all the other groups, including obviously a very vibrant tourism group and business in award-winning indeed in Arran? So how do we build that into the future for the medium and long term?
It's a very good question. Firstly, I'd probably like to just to echo what the two previous speakers have said about the scope of where you need to be focusing this inquiry. And I would suggest, briefly, a fundamental root and branch review of operating models, vessel types and service provision, which is wide ranging and it has to be wide ranging. You have to look at every element because they're so interlinked. Representation on the boards of Steamal and CalMAC particularly, we will mention this right now, we are wondering when Project Neptune report will be published. We believe that has been sat on desks in Transport Scotland and at ministerial level for some time. That is essential to help inform options. So again, you know, we would urge publication of that as soon as possible. But how can we improve community representation? Representation on boards is one step. There's a current body called the Ferry Community Board that is hand-picked by CalMAC. It is prevented from discussing issues that are not network-wide. So it doesn't really hear, or it's not allowed to communicate some of the fine detail. As Joe pointed out, all the islands are slightly different. We'll have slightly different challenges, slightly different service levels. A suggestion could be to remove that Ferries Community Board from a CalMAC entity and make that its own independent entity that would have the ability to feed into that discussion. Moving down to a more island level, yep, there are multiple different bodies involved in many of the islands. Mainly, I mean, certainly speaking from our experience, Arran Ferry Action Group exists because of a level of frustration with the current system, that we don't seem to be making progress, that we seem to be still talking about the same problems without seeing any particular solutions. Clearly, the issues up the river at Ferguson's are disastrous, really. Disastrous in many ways for the taxpayer. You know, we're paying 300 plus million pounds for two vessels. This is unaffordable. But the knock-on effect of that through the network, we're now 5 years late. 5 years ago, that vessel should have been operating on Arran. That would have allowed the old Isle of Arran to be redeployed through the network. That would have been an additional vessel to help fill some of the gaps. 802 would have come online. That would have allowed Hebrides to cascade down. And then by now, on the original vessel replacement plan, we'd have been building vessels 5 and 6, not long away from delivery, and already have 4 new vessels in the fleet. So this knock-on effect of what appears to be just a small delay to some vessels in Port Glasgow has a huge knock-on effect through the whole network.
Sorry, Sam, I'm conscious I've got other colleagues who want to ask questions, and we need to hear about the medium and long-term priorities from the others. So, Gary McLean, can I come to you? And again, I'm sorry, I'm going to have to ask you to be brief about your medium and long-term aspirations, what you think this committee should look at. Is Gary McLean still with us? If he's not, can I maybe come to Paul Riley? Okay, we've not got Paul, so I apologise for that. Lawrence, I can definitely see you, Lawrence. So have you got what you'd like us to look at from the medium and the long term?
I came in quite quickly there before, having maybe not been fully aware of the question, and just spoke about the inter-island ferries. But we also have the ferries from Shetland to Aberdeen. First of all, with the inter-island ferries, what we see as the answer is looking at fixed links. I mean, that would start the net zero thing, because tremendous pollution from the ferries, and it would start the connectivity problem. So that's what we really feel it should be looked at for the but inter-island ferries is fixed links.
So that's...
And Northlink services to Aberdeen, we need more capacity. There's a lack of capacity there. We need to look at outside the box. We need to look to see if we can get daytime runs. I mean, the ferry runs every evening from port to port, but see if we can get additional runs in through the week or larger vessels. We need to do something to improve that service.
So that's important aspects of that inter-island. And I know there are obviously other representatives that on the session today that have got that inter-island issue. And your point about fixed links, I can't say exactly where the committee will go, but we're looking at wider connectivity. But the ferries are our key focus. But it's helpful to hear that. I'm going to suggest that we'll go back to the convener to move to other questioners. But I'm sure those that we haven't heard from, Paul and Gary, can probably come in at some point about their medium and long-term views for the committee as we progress this session. So I'll go back to you, convener.
Thank you very much, Fiona. Let me bring in Liam Kerr to be followed by Monica Lennon. Liam, over to you, please.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. I will direct one question only. I'll direct it to Margaret and Joe, but I'm conscious, based on your submission, Sam, that you might want to come in at the end of this. Margaret first. The question is this. Where do you believe that decisions on ferry service provision, vessel specification and procurement are best taken in this area? Should this be national organisations like CMAL, like Transport Scotland, or should it be the local authority, or indeed should it be somewhere else, such as a transport forum?
Hello there. I believe it should be taken by the local council in consultation with chief engineer and somebody who actually knows about boats, because I think this is the crux of the problem. It's interesting when you hear, I was going to say men or women in suits, and that's not fair, but when you hear people who are not hands-on practitioners talking about design of a boat, and if you have a chief engineer, or indeed if you have a retired captain or a current officer who hears this, they will say, well, actually, that's not right, because it's a bit like driving a car and somebody who doesn't have a license. You have to know your subject. And I don't believe that those people making decisions know their subject, because we all need expert advice, do we not, from people who are an authority on whatever it is. You wouldn't take your car to a plumber to get fixed, and yet you would take it to a car mechanic. And yet we will have people sitting around the table making decisions on what type of vessels, on the sailings, on what locals need. And as I've already alluded to, we don't even have an island representative on the CalMAC board. So who sitting around that board knows what it's like to live in a community where you are told your ferry is cancelled within a few hours of you going anywhere? Or again, if you're an essential worker trying to get to Barra, where you've got two ferries, you're told actually the ferry is full and you find it's not. It's those little things. So having local, somebody around the table who actually knows what they're talking about, who's been into an engine room, who knows about engines, who actually has stood and has steered a ferry into Loch Maddy or a Drossen or whatever it is, that's the sort of people we need to be listening to, I think. I'm not, of course, we need the management there as well. And of course, there are financial constraints, and we all understand that. We really do. And I think over the years, we've been very flexible. We've worked so well with CalMAC. The frontline staff, the immediate management of CalMAC, are amazing. The local staff, the crew on the ground will do everything they can to help you to get onto the ferry. But their hands are tied as well. So let's get our chief engineers and our captains around the table.
Thank you very much for that. Joe, I'll throw you the same question. You made some comments earlier about vessel size and capacity. Is Margaret right about where the decisions on the service provision and the capacity should be taken at local authorities with chief engineers and someone who knows?
Well, I think, I mean, the key issue here, as I sort of said in previously, is the quality of the decision making, the influences on those decisions. In order, what we need to spend our money better, not because we need to cut costs, but because we need to improve services. The only way we can afford to improve services is if we do more with the money that we already have, because there is, you know, there's plenty of money there. You know, the money that's being spent is huge. It needs to be spent better. So who is best placed to make those decisions? Well, government should not be making operational decisions. Government should not be making decisions about what type of ferry to buy, what fuel it should use, or you know, how many crew it should have. The government should be setting strategic policy objectives, and the operator should be challenged with meeting those objectives. And if they are challenged to meet those objectives, they will find the technical and operational solutions to meet them. For example, if looking at our own island of Mull, at the moment we're just engaging on a vessel replacement process for our main vessel, the Isle of Mull, and it's very much focused on what should the vessel be? What should the vessel be? So we have public servants, CMAL and CalMAC and community representatives saying, what should the vessel be? But that's not what we should be asking. We should be asking, what service do we want? The question should be, what is the service that this island needs in terms of capacity, frequency, length of operating day, and emissions, critically, as well? And those are the key sort of strategic policy objectives that should be set. And then it should be up to the operator to find the technical and operational solutions to meet those objectives. And if you either do that by some process within a public framework, but I think that's a very difficult thing to achieve. I've got to, it's very difficult to get the best spending decisions out of a public system. If there were competing operators for those services, they would have an interest in finding the best way to meet those strategic outcomes. Our main vessel, the MV Isle of Mull, it does 10 return trips a day with a crew of nearly 30 people on it. If you set the policy objective of maximizing frequency, you could use those same number of people and run three vessels. You could have three vessels with 10 crew on each, and you could triple your frequency using the same number of crew. You could more than double your capacity, but you'd be doing it much more cost effectively. And unless we have people who are making decisions around searching for cost effectiveness, productivity and efficiency, we'll not be able to afford to improve our service. The service has not improved in decades, because every time we look for an improvement, the cost of that improvement is huge because of the massive operating costs that are baked into the system. We need decision makers who have a vested interest in running a productive, efficient ferry service. And that's the question. How do you incentivize decision makers to make those good decisions? And obviously, one answer is that you have private operators who are competing for a public service contract, and they are competing against one another to meet those public policy objectives as cost effectively as possible, or you have some structure within a public framework that encourages that. But I mean, at the moment, Transport Scotland, for example, they have no shipping professionals in their team. The one group of advisors they did have has been disbanded. They may all be capable, intelligent people, but they do not have shipping experience. Yet these are the people that are making, operational and planning decisions for a shipping business. We need more professionalism, knowledge and experience and incentivization to get the right decisions. I don't know if that answers the question, but I hope so.
Yeah, like Margaret's answer before, I think that was a really useful summary, Joe. Yeah, and just finally then, I'll throw to Sam, just because I thought the submission that came in had some fascinating points on this area. Sam, I wonder if there's anything you want to add to those two answers that we've heard already about where decision making about provision, procurement and specification should be made.
Yeah, echoing both previous speakers there. I think fundamentally Joe is right where we should be separating the specification into two elements. We shouldn't be trying to specify the vessel at government level. We should be specifying the service requirement. And that is a very robust and clear definition that defines the principal requirements that the vessel must meet. So how many people per day must it move from A to B? How many cars from A to B? How long should its operating day be?
And also, critically, what about its emissions, obviously, on the path to net zero? Now, that should be the outline specification that then gets given to the operator. The operator is the one who is then motivated to meet that criteria in the most cost-efficient way. That may mean multiple vessels. There are many benefits to the multiple vessel route. Increased frequency is the key one, but also significantly increased redundancy. If one vessel breaks down, say you have three vessels on a route, you still have two vessels, so you've only lost 30% of your capacity. The recent examples throughout the network, let's take the example up in Stornoway when Lough Seaforth goes down, that's 100% of the capacity gone. There is no redundancy. So then vessels have to be moved around the network, which then you're taking other vessels off other routes, which then impacts their capacity, which then has knock-on effects everywhere. It would be more manageable to have multiple smaller units. But those questions should be for the operator on long-term contracts, so they've got the time to get return on their investments, to deliver the specification as described by the very clear and robust service requirement. The thing is, it's such a huge area. There's so many interlinked things. But again, the fundamental service requirement needs to be informed by what the island communities, businesses, and require from its core lifeline service. And from there, it will kind of look after itself.
I understand. Thank you very much all for your answers. Back to you, Convener. No further questions.
Okay. Thank you very much, Liam. Next up is Monica Lennon, to be followed by Jackie Dunbar. Monica, over to you, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. It's been very helpful and informative so far, and I think a few of my questions have already been answered in your contributions. But just thinking again about vessel size and capacity issues. So looking at the written submission we've received from the Harris Transport Forum, I'll come to Margaret first. Margaret, you say in the submission, or the forum says, that you're of the view that medium-sized vessels will provide a more resilient and more convenient service in the long term. I'm just going to come to you just to, you know, explain that further and invite other panellists to join in. So, Margaret, please.
Yes, we feel that having two smaller vessels would be far more efficient and effective than having one large vessel, because if the Lough Seaforth was to go off or have an engine malfunction, it's off. Whereas if we had two smaller ferries, then you've got more resilience. And that's what, had we been consulted about the new builds, rather than what's being built at the moment and further things, that's what we would have opted for. Two of the ferries, the style that are being built for Islay, would be very suitable for our crossing on the Minch.
Thank you, Margaret. Sorry, I've got a window banging behind me. It's a bit distracting. I can't see the rest of the panel now. Would anyone like to add to what Margaret said, or have a different view about vessel size? Just give us a wave if you want to come in. Yes, Joe, we'll come to you, and then Sam. Thank you. Thanks.
I was told there was a button to press when I went to speak, but it's probably, yeah, it's easier to wave, isn't it? Yeah, if you speak to people all over the Hebrides, this will be what you get back all the time, is why are the ferries so big? We don't need these behemoths. This is a baffling, another baffling strategic failure, where we get these ever-increasing vessels, in size being delivered, that are inflexible, they lack redundancy. When a vessel is needed to it breaks down, you have to pinch a boat from another service. And the shore facilities that are needed, every time there is a vessel replacement, the pier needs to get bigger and bigger and deeper. There's vast sums being spent on pier improvement, so-called. Look at, where 802 is going, to Uig and across the Minch. at the time of the procurement, I think if you go back and you'll see that the ferry industry advisory group who were advising Transport Scotland at the time were strongly saying, were strongly arguing that they should buy two medium-sized vessels for that service, because at the moment there's one vessel, the Hebrides, shared effectively between two routes. So they were strongly advised both in terms of improved service, frequency and capacity, and redundancy and resilience to two vessels. But no, one vessel, one large vessel was ordered, 802. It's going to add capacity, but it's still going to be a highly vulnerable service because it's reliant on one vessel. And will not improve the timetable at all. And that's why UIG is having to have this 6-month shutdown, is to accommodate this vast vessel. Two smaller vessels have been bought. None of that would have been necessary. None of that huge capital expenditure would have been necessary, and the service improvement would have been far greater. So why are these decisions being made? The Loch Seaforth was another one. The Ullapool Stornoway service. It was strongly argued at the time by experts and locals that they wanted a multi-vessel service for frequency, redundancy, resilience, and capacity. But no, one large vessel was chosen instead. And already, the Ullapool Stornoway service shares with the Oban Craigneur service the title of the most congested in the entire network. Yet it's got the newest vessel. So, if anything's a demonstration of a failed strategy, it's that. There's a new vessel, and it's already at capacity. And as we saw last year, if it breaks down, utter chaos ensues because there's no backup on the route. So it's a fundamental strategic error that we are relying on a small number of large vessels. We should have a large number of small vessels that are more flexible and redundant and can be moved around more easily. Or if there are more of them, you don't need to move them around so easily. So yeah, vessel size is key, but it comes back to the point, why are these decisions being made? Around what basis are they being made? How are the decision makers, EMAL, CalMAC, Transport Scotland, incentivized to arrive at the best decisions? Because obviously, the evidence of recent procurement is that the wrong decisions are being arrived at. 801 and 802, prime examples, far too big, far too complex, massive vessels, really bad, hugely expensive decisions. Even if they'd come in on budget, they would have been twice the price that they ought to have been.
That's really helpful. Thank you, Joe. I'll turn to Sam now. So we've just heard from Joe about the potential benefits of a multi-vessel service. He's talked about flexibility. Keen to get your thoughts, Sam.
Yeah, the choice of vessel type and size are critical to the long-term sustainability of the service. The advantages of multiple smaller vessels and being able to adjust your capacity to demand is critical. Let's look at a couple of examples already on the network. We've already touched on the Stornoway route. Another example that is quite a good example is the Weems Bay-Rothsay route for Bute. Two medium-sized matched vessels that run a long operating day where capacity can be matched to demand. Do you hear many complaints about capacity from Bute? Not very many. You look a bit further up the river to the Western Ferries. So they have a fleet of up to four vessels that they can turn on and turn off depending on demand and match their available capacity. They're very efficient in that way. One of the problems of the current large vessel option is that while it offers capacity in the summer, in the winter, you're operating a huge vessel that's virtually empty. So again, very high cost for each passenger unit moved. And this gets down into the real root of some of the decision making. Let's use the analogy of comparing it to the railways, which we know is quite a popular subject these days. Let's consider trains between Edinburgh and Glasgow. Do you run a 10 carriage train every hour, or do you run four carriage trains
every 15 minutes, which offers the best service level? Obviously the latter. And it's that model that we need to be kind of considering for our ferry service.
Thank you, Sam. I don't know if there's any time left. Yeah, there was some mention earlier, I think it might have been Joe who talked about crews and about the number of staff on ferries. I have a question about, you know, do the panel have a view about whether crews should live on shore or either at home or in staff accommodation or on board their vessels? I'd also, you know, welcome any other comments or views in terms of workforce issues that you think the committee should be looking at. Perhaps if I come to Lawrence on that, we've not heard from you yet, Lawrence.
We're a slightly different situation with the inter-island ferries, and the crews only stay on board when they're required to at night. But with the Aberdeen service, which is sails overnight, then the crews obviously sleep on the boat during the day, depending which tide they're at. And to go forth to have additional rounds, it would mean additional crews could command the vessel and take the boat back to from Larry to Aberdeen while the northbound crew was sleeping. That would be one way of increasing the capacity.
Thank you, Lawrence. Gary, do you want to add anything?
Yeah. It's a difficult one. I mean, one issue we have at the moment is, while we're delighted to have two new ferries coming to Islay, at the moment, we still have to sort of operate in the constraints of the current service, where we've got only four boats capable of coming into Islay, and the average age is over 30. So that creates issues. And with the large amount of commercial traffic coming off this island, second only to Stornoway, Ullapool, we're asking for additional sailings, which then falls into the tripartite kind of issue of, we ask CalMac, CalMac say it's not us, it's Transport Scotland, it's a contract variation. Goes to Transport Scotland, they go, this is where it comes on to crewing. It's expensive. If we're going to run additional sailings, we're out of crew hours. We don't know anywhere that the crew can stay, because some of the vessels don't have overnight accommodation, which is suitable for the crew to be sleeping while the vessel's in operation. So it doesn't seem like it's working at the moment. I think if crews are going to be sleeping on vessels, it needs to be supplemented by onshore accommodation, or if you can recruit locally, I mean, that's an absolutely excellent way of providing a good job for local people. So it has to be a sort of strategic decision, I think, on what we want to achieve from our ferry service.
That's really helpful. Thank you, Gary, including that point about local recruitment. I'm not sure if anyone else on the panel wants to add anything. I'll pause for a moment. If not, I'll hand back to the convener. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Monica. I believe Mark Ruskell has a supplemental in this area. Mark, Mark will come in later. OK. Jackie Dunbar is up next. Jackie, over to you, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. I'm finding it very, very interesting this morning. There's been a lot touched on the passenger services today, but I've not heard quite so much regarding the freight services or also the effect it's been having on businesses. I know that Sam touched on it briefly before. So I guess what I'd like to know from the panel, if Do you have any representation in your group that feeds into your group to let you know the problems that that freight services may have and business services have? And if so, how can we ensure that we hear their voices in this inquiry? Gary, I see you nodding, so I'm gonna come to you first, if you don't mind.
Certainly. I mean, our local ferry committee tries to involve all aspects of island life, and that includes hauliers, and in particular, the main haulier that's responsible for the vast majority of goods and services coming on and off the island. So we are live to the issues that they face. But in some ways, that's ameliorated by the block booking system, which is in place for our service, which creates its own issues as well. But I mean, breakdowns and so on, it do affect the hauliers most, I would say, in terms of they're the ones that are asked to juggle things around, because it frees up the most space to allow people to get on and off the island. So they then have to deal with their customers who have an expectation of delivery. So the more disruptions there are, the closer we get to shutting down a whisky distillery from operating. And as soon as a business like that shuts down, there are massive costs. And that, obviously, there are big employers. It affects everyone. So I think we're all in it together, at least here. We try to take everyone's views, and oftentimes they're not competing. We all strive for a more reliable service which has the capacity to meet the needs of the island.
Okay. You said about block booking service. I'm a bit of a novice, I'm afraid. Can you maybe explain a bit further what that entails and what problems it can throw up?
The block booking service is basically a deviation from the first come, first serve mantra that we hear from Transport Scotland, which allows commercial ferry bookings to be made essentially on a yearly basis, saying how many sailings per week the haulier wants, how many lane metres. The issue comes with how that's managed, because if someone cancels at the last minute, then that frees up quite a lot of deck space. And I'm not entirely sure of exactly how this is operated, because there's a business-to-business team that seems to be very secretive due to commercial sensitivity and confidentiality. It deals with that within CalMac. So if there's a lot of block bookings being cancelled at the last minute with no financial penalty, then it means that there's no space for anyone else to book. And not everyone has access to that system. Whether it's that, I don't know how it's decided who is allowed block bookings and who isn't, okay, or who in fact has them.
Yeah, thanks, that was extremely helpful. Convener, I'm very wary of time, so if I could maybe ask if the others, if they wanted to feed in my answers to the committee.
Okay, Jackie, thank you very much. Next up is Mark Ruskell, to be followed by Natalie Dawn. Mark, over to you, please.
Yeah, thanks. I think we've heard some real razor-sharp evidence this morning, and it's certainly very educational. I wanted just to go back on something Joe had said around the introduction of road equivalent tariff and how there wasn't really a strategic plan around that. I see people nodding. Great. So I wonder if I could just get a bit more on that from you in terms of how you think a strategic plan around road equivalent tariffs should have been introduced. What would have been its key features? I'm just going to pick up on people who are nodding. So can I go to Sam first, please?
It's a very big question. One of the inevitable consequences of making RET was reducing the cost of ferry travel. One of the inevitable consequences of that is increasing demand, allied with the shift of a lot of the island economies to a more tourism-based economies. Demand was always going to grow. The problem that we really face, and this echoes back into the previous question about freight and commercial traffic, is that we're now facing increasing demand with broadly static capacity. So that those are, you can only fit so many vehicles on a ferry, and if you've got more demand, there's less space available. And that's part one of the real issue. Part two is increasing unreliability. So when you have cancelled sailings, that now full boat needs to be try and be accommodated on other sailings that are already full. So there's two streams to it. There's the capacity question and the reliability question, all of which are kind of were the reliability question was predictable because the fleet is getting older. The increased demand was predictable because of the growth of tourism on the islands and driven by RET.
Okay, thanks. Can I turn to others as well? Gary, do you want to come in on this?
Certainly. I can only speak to Isla, but in the past, local people were able to buy books of tickets, which allowed them a cheaper transport to and from the mainland. But when RET was introduced, that was done away with. But largely, the cost stayed the same for island residents. What it did do was drove down the price for non-residents. So that's obviously a great boon to our tourist industry. But again, as Sam said there, we've got increased demand and capacity hasn't changed at all. And in fact, it's probably decreased due to the age of the vessels lowering their deadweight tonnage. And it doesn't seem, I think we're all on the same page, that there doesn't seem to be have any impact assessment done on how that would affect local services in terms of demand.
Yeah. Which I find surprising, because there were a number of pilots done on road equivalent tariff over a number of years. But obviously it's difficult to predict. Margaret, did you want to comment on this?
Yes, I think RET for the masses really wasn't a well thought out plan. It means the Scottish taxpayer is subsidising the fare of many foreign tourists, amongst others. And the additional loss revenue would have contributed to the running costs and would have allowed, perhaps, us to have had some flexibility with funding. It's not benefited the locals, because it has benefited visitors to the island. So I feel something should be done about it, and should either be stopped completely or definitely needs reviewed.
Right. Okay. Can we go back to Joe then? You raised this initially. What are your thoughts on this? Do you think RET should go? Or?
No, RET is a fantastic thing. And that's not to say that it might not need some adjustment around the edges, but RET, as a principle, has been hugely beneficial. It's made it's made the cost of travel much less. It's been wonderful. It's had some negative consequences. It perhaps, you know, there are arguments for adjusting it and, you know, maybe not applying it universally to all traffic. It's also worthwhile pointing out that RET only applies to passenger vehicles and foot passengers. It doesn't apply to commercial vehicles. We've been promised that for years and it's never happened. Commercial vehicles travel pro rata much more expensively than any other type of vehicle, which is just, you know, stifling to business and just basically unfair. But the RET was a fantastic thing, but the uplift in demand was entirely predictable and was predicted, you know, entirely predictable, but nothing was done to prepare for it. You know, the ferries plan of 2012-2013 basically has not been implemented. You know, at the time of planning for RET, there was the ferries replacement plan that basically hasn't happened. You know, look back at the ferries plan of 2012 and you'll see the vessel replacement plan and tick off the number of vessels that have been replaced. I think you'll find there's one or two out of a list of six or eight or so. You know, the Isle of Mull was supposed to have been replaced 2-3 years ago. Hasn't happened. And that's because the pace of progress is absolutely glacial, because there's real short-termism in decision-making. We're looking at individual vessel replacements rather than a fleet plan. There should be a whole fleet plan, not just this piecemeal approach to one vessel after another. Oh, this vessel's getting old. How can we scrape the budget together? Shall we replace that one? It's entirely short-termism. Reluctance to make the capital spending leads to this continuing operational high operational costs. You know, for example, we've got the Isle of Lewis running to Barra. The Isle of Lewis used to run between Ullapool and Stornoway. It's one of the second largest vessel in the fleet, but because there was and it should have been replaced with a smaller vessel, it was like this redundant vessel. What do we do with it? You know, oh, the only two places where it can fit are Barra and Oban, so we'll put it on the Barra and Oban run. You know, this is a vast vessel for one of the smallest islands and quietest routes. Half the time in the winter, the crew equal or outnumber the number of passengers on that vessel steaming backwards and forwards between Barra and Oban. That's because there was no, you know, no one got Barra a new boat. They've got this cast off, which is utterly inappropriate for the route and is costing vast sums to crew and run because it is utterly inappropriate. So it needs a much longer term view, okay. In short.
Thanks. Lawrence, do you want to come in from a Shetland perspective?
Well, RET doesn't really affect us, I don't think.
Okay.
Okay,
that's great.
I mean, we are stuck with...
Okay, thanks, Lawrence. And Paul, opportunities come in on this? I think we're struggling to get Paul there, but if I can maybe go back go for it, Paul. We can hear.
Are you not receiving? Sorry.
Yeah, we can hear you.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Sorry. According to this, I'm on audio only.
Yeah, that's fine. We can hear
so
you.
So I apologise to my audience. The basic thing I'd like to point out is that in Orkney in particular, and I appreciate this doesn't apply everywhere, but in Orkney there are three companies running ferries. There's Orkney Ferries, which serves the Northern Isles and the smaller islands of Orkney. There is North Link, which runs the service from Kirkwall through, from Aberdeen through Kirkwall to Lerwick and back, and from Scrabster to Stromness and back. And there is Pentland Ferries. Orkney Ferries, I've already told you about the over 30-year-old boats that we have. North Link, they get a subsidy, I understand, of something in the region of £7 million a year just to run the services. And they are supposedly classified as a lifeline service. Pentland Ferries is a privately owned company, operates between Gills Bay and St Margaret's Hope. It runs the most stable vessel of them all because it's a catamaran-based vessel, and it is the most cost-effective. And most interestingly, privately owned, it makes a profit. The Pentalina, which at present is languishing in Kirkwall Harbour unused, is another catamaran vessel, excellent quality, but totally unused because apparently it's unsuitable for use with other islands. I find it extraordinary that out of three companies who run ferry systems, the only one that we know that works and is profitable is the privately owned one. They've got a spare vessel and, excuse me, surprise, surprise, Scotland apparently can't use it. I think that's pretty bad. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thanks, Paul. Okay, back to you, Convener.
Great, Mark. Thank you very much. Let me bring in at this stage Natalie Dawn, who is joining us remotely. Natalie, over to you, please.
Thank you, Convener. Hi. Good morning, everyone, and good morning, panel. Thank you very much for your comments so far. They have been very helpful this morning. So I'm interested in the role of community organisations and service provision, and I appreciate the comments that have been made so far about service requirements, and communities are obviously best placed to help shape this. So I want to expand on a point that my colleague Fiona Hislop raised in relation to community representation and how you best feel that this could be achieved going forward in the medium and long term. And within that, how do we ensure that full communities are represented? So, for example, the inclusion of young people is really important, obviously have very specific needs. So I'd just like to ask as well how young people are represented within each of your areas. If I could perhaps I'll go to Sam first, please.
I think having as wide a representation across the community is very important. That includes, as you suggest, everyone on the all of the stakeholders from old to young, all sorts of different sort of sectors of business, large business, small business, healthcare. All of these elements need to be catered for in a structure that has an effective voice. I mentioned earlier the Ferries Community Board that sits as part of CalMAC. I mean, that strikes me as a vehicle that could be an awful lot more effective if it was a more independent voice. That has representatives from pretty much every island across the network that feeds into it. That, you know, that structure is probably something that needs development to allow that community board to become a much more effective network-wide voice. As to our own committee, well, unfortunately, I am the youngest member on our committee, so that's also part of the problem with the populations of a lot of our islands, is that we are a generally aging population. But the questions on young people representation is huge. Huge question on the, let's take the example of the Young Scot card, free bus travel under 22 across the whole country, doesn't apply to ferries. Why?
Okay, thanks, Sam. Can I turn to, I'll turn to Joe next, please, if anything to add?
Yeah. I think that the greatest opportunity for the interests of younger people to be reflected in the system is basically, you know, we all share the same interests. A better connected islands, more reliable service will benefit everyone. You know, we all have basically the same need for reliability, dependability, lack of anxiety, you know, and for the ability to carry out normal life, be that for a business, being able to get a tradesman in when you need to, or be it for a school trip, being able to actually get a space on the ferry to go away to compete in a sports event, or you know, or as in our case, you know, Iona is an island off an island, and their children, in Iona, when they reach secondary school, go to Oban for school. In the winter, they're losing, I think last winter it was about 25% of their school hours, because they were, because the ferry is so unreliable in the winter that the kids are having to leave school early just to get home for the weekend. You know, there's a very direct and explicit example of how an unreliable ferry service is directly impacting on education. You know, and that kind of thing is happening all over the place. You know, and that is about not just technical reliability of the ferry. That's about the vulnerability of the service to poor weather, which is increasing. The service is getting much more vulnerable to poor weather. You know, that we're about 10 times more vulnerable to poor weather than we used to be across the board. But in terms of representation, yes, we need much more community representation. You've got to remember this whole organization, you know, the various agencies here are all vested interests in a great sense. CMAL are a vested interest. CalMAC are a vested interest. The trades unions are a vested interest, and the users are a vested interest. We all want to look after our own interests, as you know, naturally you do. But actually, the vested interest with the least power are the users. We're the ones that are actually dependent on the service, and we seem to be the ones with the least power and the least influence on the service. Yes, could the structures be better? Absolutely. But I think, you know, could the communities board be different and not handpicked by CalMAC? Could there be more, you know, less fragmentation of the agencies that are responsible? Yes. I mean, on Mull, we have a pier that's owned by the council. We have a vessel that's owned by CMAL, and we have an the service run by CalMAC, you know. And then we have Transport Scotland as well. So actually, for us, we have four different agencies to talk to. And four different representative structures, be that local councillors, ferry committee, communities board, and it's a mess. It's a total mess. That all needs cleaning up, absolutely. But it's meaningless unless the agencies themselves consider themselves accountable, if they actually recognise that they're accountable. And there is a real deficit of that. If I were to point the finger, at one of them in particular would be CMAL, I think, is utterly unaccountable. It doesn't consider itself accountable. It's making decisions that it you know, I'll send you lots of written evidence in that regard. But, you know, there is no accountability. It's great. You can have all the structures you want. But unless the agencies involved consider themselves accountable and respect the people that they are accountable to, it'll be pointless.
Thank you. I'm keen to hear the views of Margaret on this, although I appreciate, I'm not sure if you have anything to add, but if I'd like to bring you in if you do. Thanks.
Thank you, Natalie. From our perspective, I think we would all agree that getting the young to engage on committees is obviously difficult. You really have to go out and find their views. And it's a very good point, because the young is our future, and we really need to look at that. I think good engagement with the local authority is important, because the local authority are constantly speaking to the young. They speak to the young through the schools, through the sports, and they also have the work with teachers. So we will hear in the Harris Forum, we will hear through our council representatives, who I feel certainly from our perspective in Harris, they are very involved in the young. We hear through the youth development worker as well in Harris. And because it's a relatively small community, you do get that the views. It's much easier, I think, to collate views. But it's the young of the future, and it's so important to involve them however we can. And also, I think, because we don't want the young to feel this is a hopeless situation, we have to be cautiously optimistic that things will improve, because life in the Western Isles is generally, it's wonderful. And we want the young to stay here. We want them to come back here, because without them, we have no future. And that's the stark reality. So engagement with the young is absolutely imperative.
Thanks very much for your comments. I appreciate those were quite thorough responses, so I'm conscious of time. I'm happy to bring anyone else in if you have anything to add, but otherwise I will just pass back to the convener. Thank you.
Okay, Natalie, thank you very much. Monica Lennon has a follow-up question, so let me bring in Monica.
Thank you, convener. Yeah, my question was for Paul, because you mentioned at the very beginning of your remarks today about some of the challenges around disabled access and the quality of accessibility issues. Some of the committee recently visited Orkney as part of a separate inquiry, so we got some insight into the issues that you've mentioned. I just wondered, Paul, if you want to elaborate and what this means, not just in Orkney, but in terms of Scotland's ferry fleet, what we should be looking at in the inquiry in relation to disabled access, accessibility issues. Paul, are you able to hear us?
Yes, I can. I am speaking. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. The basic problem with all our transport is mobility. Nobody with any mobility issues can leave the vehicle if they are on two out of the three ferries. And obviously, it's very difficult for mobility issued people to get into a small plane with restricted access. It's difficult enough for able-bodied people. The problem with the ferry is compounded by the fact that, in theory, nobody should remain on the car deck while the ferry is moving between ports. But obviously, they have to stay in the vehicle if they can't get out or can't get upstairs. And in some cases, a carer has to stay with them. Basically, that is true, as far as I am aware, for all the ferries. The only one with ramps that I can think of is the Alfred, part of the Pendon Ferries fleet. I believe, thinking about it, the yes, obviously, Northlink, on both their routes, they have lifts on their larger vessels, so people are able to get around to some extent that way. But inter-island, it's virtually impossible. And this, of course, isn't just people with direct mobility issues. It's people who, for instance, have come back from hospital with serious operations or needing to be accompanied to make sure they can get home okay, etc., etc. Thank you.
Thank you, Paul. It was really helpful to get that on the record. I'm sure the committee will want to explore these issues and the points that have been made by other colleagues today about, you know, these are lifeline services, access to the NHS and healthcare and so on. So these are really important points that you've raised. Back to you, convener.
Thank you very much, Monica. That brings us to the end of our allocated time. So let me thank our panellists for joining the committee this morning and sharing your views and concerns. I think we've covered a lot of ground. If there were other issues you wanted to bring up, please feel free to write to the committee, to send an email, or to provide follow-up supplementary evidence by sending that to the clerks. The session we had this morning will help the committee inform our final remit, which we will be signing off shortly. So thank you once again for joining us. We very much appreciate your time and for the serious issues you have just raised with the committee. I will now suspend the meeting for 10 minutes. Thank you very much. Welcome back, everyone. Our next agenda item is the consideration of three petitions. I refer members to paper three, which provides some background information on each petition, each of which we have looked at before as a committee. The first petition we will consider is petition 1750. It was lodged by Alex Hogg of Scottish Gamekeepers Association in August 2019. It calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to introduce independent monitoring of satellite tags fitted to raptor species in order to assist the police and courts in potential wildlife crime cases and to provide data transparency. On the 15th of March, we agreed to keep the petition open and to write to Nature Scot and Police Scotland for views on the implementation of new data sharing protocols in the first year and also in relation to the robustness of the data being gathered. We also agreed to write to the Scottish Government to ask for its views. All three have replied. I also note that we have received correspondence, a late submission from the Scottish Gamekeepers Association. I now invite views of committee members in relation to how we take this petition forward, and I refer you to paragraph 11 of the paper. Mark.
Thanks, Convener. I mean, obviously, the satellite tagging of raptors is hugely important, not least because it enables us to detect wildlife crime. However, you know, that process needs to be robust and it needs to be transparent and have the confidence of all stakeholders. So I was pleased that we got a submission back from Nature Scot identifying that there are now new data sharing protocols that are in place that perhaps weren't in place when this petition was originally submitted. And they believe that it provides, you know, important oversight. The data's there to provide oversight. This is being done competently and professionally and in an open way, and I know that Police Scotland are happy with that protocol that's in place as well. So I think on that basis I would suggest that we would close this petition, but obviously, you know, we'd want to keep an eye on how satellite tagging is progressing in Scotland, and it may well be a question we may wish to raise with Nature Scot when the opportunity next arises in this committee.
Yeah, thank you very much, Mark. I would agree with that. Do any other members want to come in? Okay, well, I think on the basis of what Mark has said and on the basis of the replies, the very helpful replies we have received, I think we can conclude that the petition be closed on that basis, but also agree that we will invite stakeholders into the committee in future to monitor the subject matter covered by the petition. Thank you very much. We now turn to petition 1815. This petition was lodged by Steve Micklewright on behalf of Trees for Life in August 2020. It calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to initiate a programme to translocate protected beavers to suitable habitats outside existing beaver range in order to minimise the need to kill animals adversely impacting arable farmland. The last time we considered this petition was on 15th of March. We decided to write to Nature Scot and the Scottish Government seeking further information and clarification about licensing and relocation. We also agreed to write to the Rural Affairs, Islands and Natural Environment Committee to draw the petition to its attention in the context of any future work on new rural support schemes. I now invite views of members in terms of how to deal with this petition, noting in particular paragraph 24 of the paper. Mark.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I think this was a very timely petition that was brought in front of this committee. Obviously, we've seen some progress from the government in relation to translocations, the first licensed translocations in Scotland. That's very welcome. But, you know, there will be ongoing issues around the National Beaver Strategy that I think needs some scrutiny. So I would suggest closing this petition, but for the committee to keep one eye on the National Beaver Strategy. And again, if there's an opportunity to scrutinise that when it's launched, I think that would be very useful because it will bring up lots of questions around ongoing management of beavers, including translocations. And I think that would be the best way to take forward the issues that this petition raises.
Thank you very much, Mark. Does any other member want to come in? Okay, on that basis, I agree with Mark. I think it's important to note the Scottish Government has changed its position on translocation, and Nature Scot has stated it now expects to see a much higher proportion of the animals needing to be removed being trapped and translocated, and a much smaller proportion removed by lethal control. So on that basis, we will close the petition, but we will look to hear from stakeholders on a national beaver strategy at a later date. Thank you very much. Finally, the petition 1872 in relation to ferry services was lodged by Liz McNichol in May 2021 and calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to urgently ensure that all islanders have access to reliable ferry services. We last considered this petition on 15th of March and agreed to postpone consideration to a later date because we anticipated that we would start a ferry-related inquiry that would deal with the issues raised in the petition. We have now started that ferries inquiry, which will cover the issues raised in the petition, and on that basis, my suggestion would be that we close this petition. Is that agreed? That is agreed. Thank you very much. That concludes the public part of the meeting, and we will now go into private session.